There's this idea in physics that nothing can travel faster than the speed of light. And it seems strange at first, but it's true. It has to be true. If the speed of light is really constant from all reference frame, as postulated by special relativity, it is almost inevitable to have a cosmic speed limit. If not, the universe would behave in ways we can't even imagine. Let's start. Suppose you are moving in the direction of a light beam. What would you measure to be the speed of light? This was essentially the question that bothered Einstein and led him to the entire theory of special relativity. Our intuition tells us that we'll measure a slower speed of light, because in our day-to-day world, velocities too simply add up, in this case with a negative sign. But this just doesn't seem right, because Maxwell derived the speed of light from other constants appearing in his equation and found a single speed at which all electromagnetic waves should travel. But then, how could a variable speed of light from different frames of reference could be true along with a single speed of light? And so the theory of special relativity came into being with the idea of a constant speed of light from all reference frames. And this changed everything, literally. Think about it this way. What is velocity? Velocity is a measure of how much space we've covered and how much time. And so if different observers with different velocities are to measure the same speed of light, something has to change. And what would that be if not space and time themselves? And so we come in front with effects such as time dilation, in which for a moving observer, the flow of time slows down, and length contraction, in which the length of a moving object appears to be contracted in the direction of motion. These effects, when combined in the right way, work just the way they should for everyone to measure the same speed of light. The speed of light in our world is really connected with other things we normally don't think much about. Causality. It is the idea that causes come before their effects. And this intuitively makes sense to us because, well, this is how our world works. When we say that the speed of light is the fastest, there are a lot of nuances that remain. Like, it's not just about light. It's about any kind of information or effect. Like, if you did something, the fastest speed at which its effect can travel is the speed at which light travels in vacuum. And it's not even just a coincidence that light travels at the speed of causality. But this idea of cause and effect is really dependent on our perception of time. Let me explain. I told you that the faster something moves, the more time slows down. That means, for a moving observer, the time interval between cause and effect will be shorter than for an observer at rest. The moving observer just sees much more of the outside world in less time. This trend continues until we reach light speed, at which point something remarkable happens. Time comes to a halt, and cause and effect happen simultaneously. I know, this sounds weird, even paradoxical. It will be like you threw the ball up and caught it at the same instant. Sounds bizarre, right? Yet this is how we think all of the massless things in the universe, like light and gravity, must behave. From our perspective, it might seem like light takes 8 minutes to reach Earth from the sun. But from light's perspective, it all happens at an instant. I know, it's complicated, but you know what? It could have been worse. Think about it. In our day-to-day slower than light speeds, time moves forward. Cause is followed by effects. At light speed, time stops. Cause and effect sit on top of each other. You know what's going to come next, right? What if it was possible to travel faster than the speed of light? Time would have gone backwards. So time travel would have been a reality. That's good. Maybe not entirely, as it would have broken causality. Effects would have happened way before their causes. And I have no words. I don't know how good or bad such a universe would have been. But the idea of causality, which seems so much more fundamental to our world as it is now, would have gone. Bulbs would have turned on, followed by turning on of the switch. It would have been weird. And this is probably why it is good that traveling faster than light is not possible. Otherwise, the universe as we know it would have not existed the way we know it. So what would it feel like to have a cosmic speed limit? Is it gonna be like you're moving faster and faster when suddenly you just can't move any more fast however hard you try? Well, actually, no. Instead, you'll always be able to move faster and faster without ever coming to an end. And yet, you'll never quite reach the speed of light. Interesting, isn't it? It takes a lot more energy to accelerate an object near the speed of light than it does when the same object is at rest. Which means the faster something moves, the harder it gets to make it move faster. It's almost as if something is continuously acting against your motion. What is it? Inertia. But inertia comes from mass, and mass is equivalent to energy. It is the increase in energy of the object that makes it difficult to accelerate. We know that an object in motion has more energy than if the object was at rest. This is because it takes energy to make something move. And so the fact that inertia increases with velocity is not that much complicated. The twist is how much inertia increases. In our day-to-day speeds, the kinetic energy can be defined with a really good equation, half mv squared. But at high velocities, it fails. From special relativity, a more accurate kinetic energy equation includes a factor of gamma, which approaches infinity as the velocity of the object approaches the speed of light. What is gamma? Remember I told you that to make the speed of light constant from every reference frame, an observer's measurement of space and time must change. Well, gamma is essentially that factor by which the change occurs. It comes from Lorentz transformations. Similar to how Newtonian mechanics is based on Galilean transformations, in which velocities simply add up, special relativity is based on Lorentz transformations. And so it takes more and more energy for an object to accelerate the nearer it is to the speed of light. And so for a massive object, it will take an infinite amount of energy to move at the speed of light, which as of now is not possible, even in theory. But how does everything work out this way? And why? Well, you know what, there's a way of thinking about all of this that actually makes a lot of sense and in some sense gets a lot more deeper into the fundamental workings of the universe. And it's also a bit more satisfactory. It goes like this. In special relativity, space and time are not really separate entities. Time is also a dimension, just like space. And when you think about it this way, a lot of things become apparent. Like, we don't just have velocity through space. We also do have a velocity through time. We can even namely say that we are moving at the speed of 1 second per second through time relative to ourselves. And if we interpret this mathematics in the right way, it hints at the possibility that everything in the universe is actually moving through the combined dimensions of space and time at the speed of light. I know, I just said a lot in really few sentences and it could be really hard to grasp the idea of combining of velocities in space and time. But the thing is that once you accept this notion, a lot of things start making sense. Like when an object is not moving, all of its speed is through the time dimension. You can even say that the object is moving at the speed of light through time. But when that object starts moving, some of its speed from the time dimension gets transferred to the spatial dimensions. And so the speed of the object in the time dimension slows down. And when the object reaches the speed of light through the spatial dimensions, there's just no speed left for the time dimension. And so the flow of time for that object stops, as it happens with massless things like light. This idea makes it really clear as to why nothing can travel faster than the speed of light. Because there isn't a speed faster than the speed of light. Speed of light is the only speed that actually exists. And you know what? Let's just forget about traveling faster than the speed of light. We cannot even go slower than the speed of light. This idea makes for a really good physics joke. And now we can announce to the world that we are moving at the speed of light through time.